Do walls separating balconies require an FRL? So this is a question about specification C1.1, fire-resistant construction. Specifically, do we have to provide fire-resisting construction in spots like these? So these are all individual units, and between the two units, we've got this sort of screen wall attached. Now, before you think, oh yeah, the answer's there because this building's built, this building's in Austria. You might have the building code of Austria, but this building isn't subject to the building code of Australia. So if it was in Australia, under the building code of Australia, BCA, do we have to provide an FRL to these little screen wall arrangements there? Protection of openings. So we've got a thought about protection of openings. So we've got we can call that our external wall there. But when we've got these little screen, so it's a very funky zigzag arrangement, but these are all balcony. Actually, we'll get on plan. I'll put the question to it this way. Here's the top level of this building. We've got a fire-resisting wall between the two SOLOC units. Does that wall need to extend across the balcony like that? Question mark, yes or no? Is anybody brave enough to say yes or no?
I was more going to say the problem with the BCA stems from there's no actual distance that says when you take the leading edge of the balconies as the external wall.
And again, this is a comment. The comment was, if you didn't hear, that the BCA doesn't specify the distance from where it becomes an external wall or not an external wall. Judgment. We're always providing judgment, particularly when you've got things like winter gardens. Where is the external wall? This case, we'll call the external wall for the purpose of today right here, and this, therefore, the balcony. And we've got these sort of screen arrangements. Do we have to fire rate that one? No one's game. No. Any yeses in the room? No yeses in the room. Oh, we got one yes and the rest are no. Let's go through the provision, shall we? So we're looking at tables 3, 4 and 5 of spec C1.1. Table 3 for type A, 4 for type B, table 5 for type C construction. Now there's a number of reasons for these tables in structural adequacy, CP1, but we're looking today about CP2, controlling the spread of fire within a building. And for the purpose of the exercise, we're going to go to table 3. And here's part table 3 of spec C1.1. And first thing to note that we're looking at walls between or bounding sole occupancy units. What's a sole occupancy unit? Defined term, it is a room or other part of the building which is for occupation to the exclusion of others. So this could be your apartment building, like in our example here. It could be the cafe down the road. That's a sole occupancy unit because it's occupied to the exclusion of others. My mechanic, his workshop is in a building which he shares with an air conditioner installer. So his part is a sole occupancy unit. It's a part which is to the exclusion of others. So we come to our top floor here. Here is an apartment. It's a dwelling to the exclusion of others. That's a sole occupancy unit. But that's not all to the SOLOC unit, is it? Because when I step out onto my balcony or onto my terrace, it is to the exclusion of others, is it not? So everything here in blue is a SOLOC unit. It is a part of the building which is for the occupation to the exclusion of others. And so it follows that we've got this part here between my terrace and the neighbour's terrace, which is going from one SOLOC unit to the next, and we've got this little screen wall in Austria. And under the BCA, that's okay. That construction is fine because you'll note that it applies to internal walls between or bounding sole occupancy units. That's not an internal wall, is it? So as our friend pointed out, where is the external wall of the building? We've identified that our little part area, the screen wall, defining one SOLOC unit from the next, is not an internal wall. Therefore, it is not caught by table 3 here. Now, I have to point out that there's plenty of reasons why a part of a building would need to have a fire resistance level. It could be support of another part. You know, the floor above might need an FRL in support of another part. You need to support that below. Could be the location of the boundary would necessitate making an element in a building have an FRL. But what I'm saying is, and I've noticed that everybody, practically everybody agreed with this, you can't point to this table and say that you need to put fire-resisting construction between one silo unit and the